All right, welcome to MBAA 601. This is basically a stats course. I think it's called Quantitative Methods in Business Research, but basically we'll learn statistics and we'll learn how to apply those to business decisions, business types of situations. Today, I will go over the syllabus, just give you an idea of how the structure of the course is gonna work. And then we've got material for today, which we will go over, and I'll explain how I want to make that as interactive as possible. I know statistics can be difficult to learn sometimes, so I've got it laid out in a way which I think will work well. And I've tried to make some improvements from the last time I've taught this course to get you involved a little bit more, get some exercises in class to just really learn this material. I think very quickly about how we can apply this to business settings, business types of situations. So, let's take a look at the syllabus. I know it's boring to slug through the logistics and you all want to get straight to quantitative questions, but let's make sure we're clear on everything. So, syllabus, we've got some basic information at the top. My name, my contact information. I have an office in Dobbs Ferry. I'm there most days, but Wednesday, obviously, I'm here. I could always meet you before class if you have questions, meet you after class, or you could schedule time to come to Dobbs Ferry. Sometimes I'm in Manhattan, too, if that's possible, in West 35th, if that's convenient for you. But I will be around by appointment. Course description is that. Prerequisites. Did you all take Turbo or did you take the 507?
507.
You took five. You took 507 and you took Turbo? And you had me for Turbo? All right. Good. Good. Okay. You remember that? All right. Excellent. And you two, Henry and Stephanie, you took 507. Did you do some stats in 507?
A little bit.
All right. A little bit. All right. Well, this course is designed. If you know nothing at all, you can absorb the material, but it's always good to have had a little bit of understanding of stats, and so hopefully all that will help. And Catherine, this is actually just a shortened version of the lecture that I gave for Turbo, which is kind of funny. When I do this in actual class and I actually ask students to, you know, give me answers on it, I realize that you know, it's not as easy as it seemed when it was in Turbo, so it's good to just ingrain it a little bit more. All right. That's the attendance policy. That's just the college policy that I'm required to paste in. Don't worry too much about that. Other than that, this quarter I have added a class participation component to class. In past classes, I just said, you know, come if you want to come, don't come if you don't want to come. I video record most classes so you can watch them online. But I found that it's just, even if people don't want to do it, if they don't want to admit it, you really need to participate in a discussion about these concepts in order to learn them. You can't learn anything quantitative. You can't learn math just by listening. You have to actually write it out, do it. And even better, if you can discuss it amongst yourselves, explain to someone sitting next to you, this is how to read the table, this is how you know, do the Z-score, the whatever. So I've got some of those exercises and added a class participation component. All right, the required course hours. So this is just some verbiage that the state requires us in terms of giving you 3 hours of credit. And the bottom line on that is we are required to have you in class for 30 hours, which we do. And we're also required to give you approximately 105 hours of outside work, which I think is a good, reasonable amount of work for this class. That would be about 10 and a half hours per week outside of class. Does that sound like? That probably sounds like a really high amount to you based on other classes, or high amount, low amount. And then I guess we're being recorded, so hopefully no one from the state is watching. But, you know, I think 10 and a half hours is a reasonable expectation here. Hopefully you do a little bit of pre-work, look at some of the material ahead of time, and then you'll have homework. which you'll just do to prepare for the weekly quizzes. You'll have some Excel exercises, and then you'll have the weekly quizzes. So I think 10 and a half is reasonable expectation. And this is stuff that is cumulative. So what I teach you tonight will be stuff that you'll use the whole rest of the quarter. So you want to just have it down, because you don't want to be trying to relearn stuff that we talked about in the first class when you're trying to do much more complicated things later on down the line. So 10 and a half hours I think is a good estimate, and you really want to put that time ahead in the beginning. Okay, so academic integrity policy on page 2 and page 3. This is actually just our new academic integrity policy, which you can read if you need some reading material late at night. But the thing that's important here, and I'll talk about this just a little bit tonight, and I'll talk about it a little bit tomorrow, or not tomorrow, next week, once you understand the logistics, is there will be a number of online quizzes. So for each week, I will teach you the material. I'll assign you some homework to practice that material, homework which you will not need to turn in, but you'll just do it to practice. There'll be some Excel exercises, which you will turn in, and that'll also be another chance to practice the material. And learning something in Excel is something that you might be able to use going forward. You're probably not going to do actual statistics problems in your job, but you may be required or need to build an Excel spreadsheet which has some statistics in it. So I think that homework is good, useful stuff too. All right, anyway, so I said I'd teach you stuff. I will give you homework to practice the stuff. You'll do Excel exercises. You will take the quizzes online each week. And the quizzes are at your convenience. So the material for tonight, you'll take a quiz on that anytime starting now, between now and next Monday. And it'll be 5 or so questions approximately. Once you take the quiz and submit the answers, you will see the answers. You will see the answer key. So you'll see what you got right, what you got wrong. You won't see an actual grade because I need to go through and check it and assign you points, but you will see the actual answers. It'll flash up one time, and you will always be able to access those, and I'll show you in a minute kind of how you can access those on Blackboard. So anytime throughout the week you're looking back, you can go and you can look at those and you can access those. And I think that is useful for learning the material, because when I test you on something, I'm just telling you that this is the thing that you need to know, this is the thing you need to understand to grasp the material, to get through the next class, and to relate it to our business questions and do analysis with it. And I've tried to make that as convenient as possible by letting you take it at any time and letting you see the answers right away. The problem is that it is sometimes tempting for students, hey, how you doing?
Hi.
It is sometimes tempting for students to share answers with other people. So for example, if one person has taken the quiz Tuesday night, person who takes the quiz Thursday night, you know, might say, hey, can you tell me the answer, yada, yada. I understand that that gets tempting, especially if you're having trouble with the material, but I ask that you please not do that. Hey, what's your name, by the way?
Calvin.
Calvin, all right.
Yeah.
Calvin, welcome. I'm Professor Williams. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mention that. Zach Williams.
I remember I had you,
Professor
I
Williams.
Had you in Turbo.
Oh, excellent.
One of the Turbo classes, I think for statistics, I think.
Okay,
yeah.
All right. Well, we're doing more statistics tonight, so that's
okay.
Great.
Sounds good.
Okay, so we're on the academic integrity issue. It's not that I give a long lecture on cheating, you know, at the beginning of each class. It's just you happen to walk in there. All right, so I have had students fall victim to that temptation to share answers with each other, and I recommend you do not do that for a number of reasons. One, because obviously you're only cheating yourself if you share answers, give answers to other people, and you're not learning the material, you're not getting as much out of your education as you could. The other reason is that it is awfully easy for me to see when that happens. Especially you all, because there's only 6 people registered for this class. Oh, here we go. And I guess, I imagine we'll probably get all six people straggling in at once. Hey, what's your name, buddy?
Mike.
Mike, oh, good to see you again.
How are you? How's everything?
Okay. It's really easy for me to see that when it happens, especially if I see someone who's struggling during class and they get all the answers right just perfectly the way that I articulated them on the answer key. And then, initially, all the quizzes I give you will be the same, and it'll be more tempting there, but what I'll do ultimately is I'll do different versions of the quiz. I don't want to scare anyone, I just want to create an environment where we all hold ourselves accountable and we all do not share answers during the quiz. So I've created multiple versions of many of the quizzes. And I have been known to give individual people individual quizzes when I see that weird things are going on with that. Okay, so I won't spend too much time on that. I just want to mention it. I will, like I said, I'll mention it again next week because now you just kind of have no idea how the course works. And once you see how it works and you see that there's the temptation to do that, I'll just remind you of that. And hopefully we won't have any issues with that. Because it's the worst, right? Me thinking that there's some sort of cheating going on, us having to have a very difficult conversation. If it's even worse, if I set up some trap where I give you a different version of a quiz and I see evidence of that, and you'll see that I really want you to learn this stuff. And it just creates the wrong discussion for us to be having if something like that happens. All right, so that's your brief explanation on academic integrity for tonight. Question, Stephanie.
What's usually the format of the quizzes? Are they multiple choice?
They are almost all short answer.
Okay.
So it'll be, what's the probability? And it'll be like a percent, like 74% will be the answer.
Okay.
A couple of them are multiple choice, but not very many.
Okay.
All right. So class etiquette, attendance, workload. I'll start right on time. Often the first few minutes will be an important review, so I would recommend you try to make it on time. We can kind of have a discussion if it's not possible, and we can try to figure out the best way. But I will start right on time. I'll try to get you out at a reasonable hour if possible. Like I mentioned, I've tried to incorporate some class participation, some class exercises into this class in particular, because I've learned that people need to participate a little bit more. So we may have some times where we go all the way up until 9:30. That certainly could be possible. But if we do, it's going to be because we have exercises that I think are important for you to spend some time on. So even though I'm keeping you here right till the very end, you may or may not believe this, but it will be saving you time, because if you're, you know, having to do more homework on your own, if you're able to do less homework on your own because I teach you more in class, I think that's a worthwhile investment of having you stay a little bit later. All right. Textbook. Did you all get my email about getting the textbook? All right. Some of you did. Do you all have the textbook?
I didn't get the
email. You didn't get the email or the textbook. Okay. Okay. All right. So raise your hand if you have the textbook. It's on the way?
I'm borrowing it from a turbo classmate.
Okay, sorry, so it's coming. All right. So I would recommend you get the textbook because we will use exercises right out of that textbook. And we will do that during class. You will need to look at various tables in the back of the book. Let me click it is. Let's see if we can get you a picture of the textbook here. There we go. All right, that is our textbook. All right, it's not cheap. It may cost you like $150, $170 online. Sorry, but it's a worthwhile investment. I would recommend also that you get this version. I have had students try to use older versions. Some people managed it, but I think it's a headache.
You're okay with the ebook, right?
Oh yeah.
Okay, because I think to rent it, it's like $55 on Kindle.
Okay, if you're comfortable with that. Sometimes it is hard, however, like when you're trying to flip back and forth. Let's see here. When you're trying to flip back and what happened here? Oh God, no. All right, I'll get back in there at some point.
been rejected, I don't know.
Okay. Anyway, when you're trying to flip back and forth through various charts, sometimes the ebook can be a little bit cumbersome, but if you're okay with that, I'm okay with that. All right, calculator. Yeah, you need a calculator in class. If you're comfortable using your cell phone, that's okay. I always find it a little bit hard to use my cell phone for lots of calculations. I think it's easier if you have a calculator that you can just punch the numbers. You can use your discretion on that. Some people also use Excel. That's possible if you're comfortable using that in class. All right. Homework and Excel exercises. So each week, there'll be recommended homework, which you will not turn in, but that will prepare you for the quiz. There will also be Excel exercises that you will do, and you will turn those in each week via Blackboard. Now, does everyone know Blackboard? Everyone know how to use Blackboard? No, is anyone new to Blackboard?
Well, I haven't used it yet, for mercy.
Okay.
I don't know if it's the same.
All right, so let's take a look. Calvin. Calvin is here, right?
Yeah.
Yes, Calvin is here. And what was your name again? I'm sorry, Michael?
Yes.
It's Michael. Michael is here. Yes. Okay. Leonard is not here. All right, so let's take a look. Turn on the light here. So this is your Blackboard. All right. You'll have the syllabus if you need it. Course material. This folder will be key. This is where pretty much everything will be. When you click on course material, you'll see this folder, class quizzes. You'll click on that and take a quiz every week. Class slides. These are the slides that I just passed out, which you have in front of you. If you miss class and are watching the video, you can find these slides. They will be useful. Another thing you could potentially do with these slides is you could look at them before class. I will have these up several days before class, and it might be easier just to flip through the slides than it would be to try to read a chapter of a textbook before we've gone over it, because the slides are where I zero in on actually what we're going to focus in on class and what I think is important for the material. And I think this is a good way to prepare. This is the way I prepared for most of my quantitative classes in business school, as I would try to get a hold of a copy of the slides before class, look them over, and just be in a good position to absorb the material. So I think that's a good resource. What else? All right, so, okay, so slides, and I mentioned you'll have some homework. Let me shift gears a minute. You'll have homework, where I will list on the syllabus. And let me just describe that. We'll come back to some of these other things and some of the things on Blackboard, but let's turn to the course schedule on page 5. All right, so in the left-hand column, you see the class 1 through 4 on that page, and if you turn the page, we've got class 5 through 10. The middle column, we've got the topics we will cover during that class. And on the right-hand column, we've got assignments. So assignments, I recommend you start before class if possible. So if you can be thinking a little bit about this material even before you come to class, that puts you in a better position to absorb it once you get here. So for example, class 1, we'll do a course overview and we'll look at the normal distribution. So your assignment for that class are to read sections 4.5, 5.4, and 6.3 in the textbook. So you'll look through that material, skim it, see what you need to reinforce what you learned in class, or just look at it a little bit in advance, warm yourself up. Work chapter two exercises one and two. So if you look at chapter two in your textbook, it has chapter exercises and they're numbered one through whatever. And so I recommend you do exercises one and two to prepare for the quiz that week. Same thing, chapter six, I've picked out 7, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16 exercises that I recommend you do to prepare for the material. All right, so two and three, those are your homework, the recommended homework assignments that I think you should do to prepare for the quiz. And number four and number five are Excel exercises. So number four, chapter two, Excel exercises one, two, and three. So at the end, so in the middle of chapter two are actual exercises. And those are homework exercises, problems I suggest you work out. But at the end, there's a section that says Excel exercises. So if you look at the end of chapter two, I think I logged myself out here, so let me do what I, see what I can do to go back in. Nothing doing here. Let's take a look. www.vitalsource.com bookshelf. Yes, of course. Oh, I'm already logged in. Good. All right, so let's take a look. So table of contents. So chapter two. All right. So chapter Excel exercises. So at the end of your book, in chapter, the end of chapter two, you'll get to this section that says Excel exercises. And I think, what are you required to do for chapter two? You're required to do one, two, and three. So you are required to do so the first exercise. So the following data is shown in the number of overtime hours worked during the past month by each of 12 employees in the shipping and receiving department. Produce a set of descriptive statistics. So here we have hours worked. Employees worked all these number of overtime hours. So there's like about 10, 12 employees here who worked. This is how much each of them worked in overtime. All right, and it's asking you for some statistics, stuff that we will go over tonight. You've probably heard before, average. All right, so compute the mean for that. So you will compute the average for these, you know, this 10, 12 numbers. Now, how will you do that? You could type those all in Excel and compute the average. But it turns out I've made it easy for you. I have produced these Excel exercise data worksheets. So, under class course material in Blackboard, you go Excel exercise data. All right. The first week's assignment is chapter two and chapter six. You'll click on that. Open it up. All right, so this actually has everything written out for you. So these were the hours in your textbook, right? And you're going to be asked to compute all of these, the orange ones, so the mean. Now, if you look on the textbook, or you look in the textbook, it will, you'll see that it describes how to calculate the mean. All right, so compute the mean. So yeah, it just goes into a description. Formulas, do this, do that, download the appropriate Excel stuff, click the equal sign. You can read all that in your textbook for a thorough explanation of how to do this. Once you do that, and once you get the hang of it, you will find that what you are ultimately going to do is, for the mean, you'll do something like this. You will type in an equal sign, open parentheses, or equals mean, open parentheses, and then you will select all of this data, close parentheses, and hit enter. Oh God. What did I do wrong? Equals mean? Mean.
Is it average, AVG?
Oh, yeah, AV, yeah, there we go, average. All right, average, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Right, it's probably the only one I remember.
So that's the one we want, average, and then you will select this data, and 35 is the average. All right, same thing here for median, or similar thing here for median. Open equals, what, median, so that's probably it. Median, open parentheses, select all of these. All right, now some of these you could just do just by looking at it without even looking at the textbook, but if you get stuck and you need an explanation of how to do this with the computer, you go back to the textbook and you say, all right, do this, yeah, okay, now I get it. All right, so those are Excel exercises. Any questions on those? All right, so once you finish all of that, you'll save it, and you will go back to Blackboard. You go to course material. I'm not 100% sure actually how you will submit this. I think you could go to class assignments. Yeah, I think you can go to that. Class assignments, go to chapter 2.6, Excel exercises, hit, all right, you're gonna submit this assignment that's worth 5 points, browse your computer, upload the Excel worksheet that you just worked on, hit submit, boom, done. Okay. So like I mentioned, I think the Excel exercises will be a good chance to learn a little bit of the material. It will also be very important, as I mentioned, in terms of something you might use in the future. You're not necessarily going to be working out statistical problems with a calculator at your desk in the future, but you may be creating spreadsheets and you may want to incorporate some of this stuff. So being familiar with how it works into Excel, I think will be helpful for you. All right, so where was I? So we looked at class slides, we looked at Excel exercise data. These class recordings, I'll record them and I'll put a link to them in here. There's nothing there right now because we just started. All right, let me go back up here to class quizzes. When you're ready to take the quiz, you'll click on the class one quiz. There'll be some instructions. I think the first 3 or 4 quizzes are 1.5 hour time limit. After that, there are 2 hour time limits because there's some more in-depth Excel questions that you may need to calculate. Most people don't take the full time, but I don't want you to be too stressed, so I give you, I think, more time than you will need. You'll click begin. Once you click begin, the timer starts, and you answer the 5 or so questions. They will all be open book, open note. Use calculator, use Excel, use whatever you need to. The only thing you can't do is work with each other or work with someone else or have any other individual help you. I definitely recommend you collaborate on homework, you collaborate on assignments, ask each other, how do you do this thing on Excel? How do you work out this homework problem? Definitely for all that homework, I would work together. But for the quizzes, you just have to do those independently. All right. So, material. So we look at class quizzes, class slides, Excel data, class video recording, class assignments. All right, I think that's everything on Blackboard. Let me show you how you might, let's do this. I'm going to open up quiz one. I'm going to begin. And try to and see. Okay, so I click on this. It's gonna ask me all right, I'll give away the first question. From these data, please find the population mean. All right, let me just guess. Let me say that it's 7. Save and submit. Okay, fine. All right, so I answered 1 probably incorrectly. And it's going to pull up the answers, and I can look at all of these and see how I did. All right, and then later when I'm looking back, I can go to my grades. I can say, all right, class one quiz. Once I grade it, I'll have a score here for you. And if I want to see the answers or the questions, I click on class one quiz. All right, and then I will click on, once I get here, I will click on one of two things. I'll either click on this if it hasn't been graded yet, or right here there will be the score you got. All right, and once you do that, you get to see all of the answers, all of the correct answers, all of your answers, and see, you know, review it that way. Okay, so I went over a little bit of how Blackboard works, how it relates to the textbook and the Excel exercises. I just gave you an example of how the quiz works. I'll, of course, go over this if you have more questions next week. I know I'm throwing a lot of information at you quickly, so we can review it as necessary. I think that's a little bit on, you know, number 6 on the homework, Excel, number 7, the quizzes and the exam. We'll talk about the exam when we get to that in a minute. All right, so let me break down a little bit more of the course schedule on page 5 and page 6. So, class 1, tonight, course overview, which we're doing now. Number 2, normal distribution. Normal distribution is that classic bell curve that you've probably seen many times. We're going to think about how that helps us with statistics. What we know, if we know things are normally distributed, why do things tend to fall into this pattern of normal distribution? And how does that help us to use it to make business decisions? Class 2, we'll talk about sampling. So if you're trying to estimate the average income in a certain town, you're trying to estimate the average amount that teenagers spend on fancy clothes, you may take a sample, and you may make an estimate based on that sample. How do we do that? We'll learn. Class 3, we will continue our sampling lecture, our sampling material, but we'll just do that with slightly different things. In class 2, we'll sample for an average, a mean. In class 3, we'll think about, well, if we're sampling for a proportion, that's a percentage, that's maybe, you know, kind of the same thing, but there's just a little bit different with the math that we need to do, and we'll learn how to do that. Mean differences, proportion differences, just an expansion of the things we'll learn in class 2. Class 4 is hypothesis testing. Has anyone done hypothesis testing before? Do you know what that is? All right, well good. Hypothesis testing is fun stuff. I think it's where we really learn how to apply business statistics to business situations. And how it works is this, is with a hypothesis test, you will pose some sort of question. And it will be an intuitive, clear, basic, simple question. It will be, does this machine work properly? Or, you know, is the average income in a certain town this amount? Or is the average error rate less than this amount? All right, so it'll be a question that has value for you for some reason. And then you will use statistical principles to answer that question. It's easy to get lost when you're just in statistical principles. But once you think about how that specifically proves or disproves some basic, useful, understandable question, then that's when statistics has value. So I'll get you warmed up with all the knowledge you need before class 4, and then class 4, we'll be able to apply those concepts of hypothesis testing. Class 5, we'll just expand our hypothesis testing. All right, then we've got spring break, the week of March 29th. No class. Class 6, we'll do regression analysis. Does anyone know what regression analysis is? All right, regression analysis is when we try to correlate one variable with another. What we mean by correlate is, suppose I know how much time someone spends online. All right, I know Stephanie spends a whole lot of time online. I know Calvin spends not very much time online. I want to see if I can gather some useful information or make a useful prediction because I know that. And maybe one thing I might be able to ascertain is how much money each of you spend online. Okay, so I know Stephanie spends a lot of time online. Calvin spends very much little time online. Does that allow me to predict that Stephanie spends much more money online? Could. It could not. We'll look at the data and we'll say, all right, based on this line of best fits, we can conclude that Stephanie is likely to spend this much more money online. But there are other factors that we need to consider. Maybe we should use a different type of regression analysis. Maybe we should add more variables. Maybe we should add a variable for how much money each of them make. Maybe we should add a variable for how spontaneous they are with their business decisions. Maybe we should add a variable for how close they live to a shopping center. And as we add more and more variables, maybe we'll be able to explain more and more why they spend what they spend online. All right, so that's regression analysis. Class 6 will do basic regression analysis, which is just one variable, i.e. how much time they each spend online. Class 7 will do multiple regression, which is more than one variable. That's when we'll add how much money they each make, where they live, how spontaneous they are, other variables like that. All right, class 8 will be chi-square tests. Chi-square is a test that a lot of statisticians use. It's not that difficult to learn. In fact, sometimes I'm tempted to teach it at the beginning of class because it's an easier one to learn. But I think it's kind of a fun way to wrap up what we know because you can see how it relates to other things that we've learned earlier in the quarter. And also, it's a test that statisticians use commonly. So you can just pull that out of your tool belt and say, I did a chi-squared test. You know what it means. You know how to use it. You know how to interface with other statisticians in a quantitative dialogue. So chi-square has a cool sounding name, can be useful, and by the time we get to that point, you'll know pretty much everything you need to know to easily absorb that material. All right, then class 9. We will review for the final. Class 10, we will take the final. The final will be comprehensive. Everything on the whole quarter will be on that test. We will come to class. We'll do it here. But it will be the same format of all of your quizzes. It will be online. You can use these computers. You can bring your own computer, whatever you're comfortable with. It will be very similar to all of the quizzes. So there will be 8 quizzes. There will be 10 questions on the final, approximately 1 question from each of the quizzes, maybe 2 questions from a couple of the quizzes. And the final questions will be essentially those quiz questions just reworded. So if you do well on the quizzes, you'll be set up to do well on the final. If you don't do well on the quizzes, all you'll need to do is review those quiz questions, make sure you understand them, make sure you know how to do the calculations, and then you'll be all set up to do well for the final. Any questions on that? All right. On page 7, we've got the grading policy. That's just our standard grade in the Mercy College MBA program. Assignments and point value is at the bottom of that page. Okay, so each of the quizzes are worth 5 points. Each of the Excel exercises are worth 5 points. Final exam is worth 36 points. Class participation is worth 15 points. So, alright, so here's my words of wisdom on the grading. The Excel exercises, you should have no problem getting 100% on all of those. Just fill it out, turn it in, you should be good. Now, I don't grade those meticulously. If you make a very decent effort, then I'll just give you 5 out of 5. I guess you all are a smaller class, I could look at them meticulously, but when I have 15 people in each class, I'm just like, all right, looks good, 5, looks good, 5, looks good, 5. And I'll probably do that with you all as well. Okay. Now the quizzes, to prepare for the quizzes, to get your 5 out of 5, I recommend you do two things, well, a number of things. Prepare for class, come to class, but then do the homework. Do the homework from the textbook after class. Try a couple of the Excel exercises to put that in context. Maybe the Excel exercises will actually help you do the homework. And the quiz will be that material. You're not going to see anything surprising. It will be all stuff that I went over in class and stuff that I suggested you practice on the homework. And that should put you in good shape to get a 5 out of 5 on the quiz. Now, I understand sometimes the quizzes can be a little bit challenging. It's the first time you're seeing the material. Maybe you didn't have enough time to do all the homework. Maybe you made a silly mistake. That's fine, because you got 5 out of 5 on the Excel exercises. Maybe you missed a couple points on the quiz, but the Excel exercises will help you balance that out. And even as the quarter is going on, you should be able to bounce back on the final, because the final, as I said, is just the quiz questions rewritten. So if you struggle a little bit on the quiz questions, the Excel exercises should bring up your grade, and you should be able to bring up your grade on the final by making sure you know the material. Additionally, the class participation, that should just be an easy 15 points for everyone. Just come to class, engage in the exercises. And I mentioned, those of you who got here a little bit later, that I've added this class participation component. I didn't do it in past classes. The reason I've added it is because I find it so important to articulate this material and various exercises. And I'm going to include various points where I'll ask you questions, I'll ask you to work on a problem in groups, and we'll think these concepts through. All right, any questions on all that? All right, boring stuff. Now we can start the fun statistics stuff. And we will go over that again. I'll go over any questions that you have next week, because I know that sometimes it can be a little bit overwhelming when you're just seeing the material for the first time. So if you have any more questions, we can definitely go over them. So I guess we're ready to start with the material for tonight. Unless I'm forgetting anything, if I am, we will address it then. All right, so let's do it. Let's start with the normal distribution. All right, the normal distribution, as I mentioned, none other than that classic bell curve. We're going to learn some of the properties associated with that. Think about how that can be useful to us. Okay. All right. Topics for tonight: to learn the normal distribution, discrete probability distributions, and continuous probability distributions. You will see the difference between those two in a minute. If that intimidates you, do not worry. Then we'll think about measures of central tendency. That basically means the center of that bell curve. How can we quantify that? In order to determine normal distributions, we'll need to think about what are non-normal distributions. So we'll talk about non-normal, and then that will roll us right into normal distributions, classic bell curve. Measures of dispersion, which means, is this a very narrow bell or is this a very wide bell curve? That will allow us to understand z-scores. We'll go over some examples of z-scores, and then we will know the normal distribution. All right, so let me start you off with your first frequency distribution. Let's take a look at this.
spend some time making sure we understand how frequency distributions work. Frequency distribution will tell us the frequency of something. So this one tells us the frequency of the number of retail stores per category at Westchester Mall. All right, so we've got Westchester Mall. We've got various categories. Clothing, jewelry, sports. And this tells us the frequency of each of these categories. So the frequency is on the horizontal axis. This happens 0 times 1, 2, 3, or 4. And this frequency or probability, the percentage of the time that it happens. So 0%, 5%, 10%, 15%, 20%. So how we would read this particular graph, this would be the probability or frequency of any of these categories having 0 stores at Westchester Mall would be 11.5%. So the probability or frequency of any of these categories having 1 retail store would be about 33%. So again, we've got various categories: jewelry, men's apparel, women's apparel, yada yada. Question for you all: what percentage of these categories have 4 retail stores at Westchester Mall?
Less than 5.
How much?
Less than 5. Is it the?
Yep, that looks right to me. So it looks like about 3%. Fantastic. So what percentage of these categories have 3 retail stores?
Like
17? Yeah, that sounds right. About 17%. All right, let me ask you the next question. So I've got these categories. I don't know how many there are. There's maybe like, so we'll say there's like 20 of them. Say I randomly choose one of these categories. What is the probability that there are no stores at Westchester Mall in that category? Let's pick jewelry. All right, let's pick jewelry randomly. What's the probability that there are 0 stores at Westchester Mall that sell jewelry?
About 11%.
How much?
About 11%, I think. 11, 12, between 10 and 15.
Yeah, so Henry's looking at this one. 0 retail stores, 11%. Okay, so, all right. Any questions on that? Does this make sense, Stephanie? Frequency distribution, probability of it happening, outcome. All right, let's look at another one, and let's see what's different. Before we look at the next one, I'll point out that this is not our classic bell curve yet. And the reason why it might not be a classic bell curve is because we're just looking at one mall. Right. Suppose we had a larger sample size, we might see something that looked a little more classic bell curve-y. Alright, let's take a look at this one. This is a frequency distribution. Number of successful sales calls for Verizon representatives out of the first 20 trials. Okay, so Verizon has these sales representatives. They try to like call people and get them to sign up for their service. All right, and are they successful in that? All right, if they're successful 20 out of 20 times, that would be 20 out of 20 successes. All right, how often does that happen?
Zero.
All right, if they are successful 0 out of 20 times, no one signs up, how often does that happen?
Zero.
Zero. All right, so this is the outcome. Number of successes could be 0, could be 20, could be anything in between. And this is the frequency, the probability of it happening. So, suppose I at random pick 1 sales representative. What is the probability that that sales representative closed 10 out of 20 deals, 10 out of his first 20 deals? Yes.
About 17.5.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. What is the probability that that representative closed between 9 and 11 deals?
Don't you average out the 3?
Don't average out the 3. You can actually just add them together.
Oh. Okay.
So the probability of being in these, there's a 16% probability being here, 16% probability here, and 17% probability here, so that's what, like 49%?
Mm-hmm.
Something like that. So the probability of being in this area of the curve, 49%. All right, what's the probability of closing 15 or more deals?
About 1.5-ish percent.
Okay, so that sounds about right. Tell me how you're getting that, though.
Because you're looking at 15 and going to the right.
Yeah, all right, so are you adding these in?
No, you're
okay.
Just going by the highest one.
Yeah,
I think.
Okay, so in order to determine 15 or more, you would look at 15 and you would add these as well. Remember the same way we added these? Alright, we just add these up here as well.
Okay.
We're saying this is all probability. And all of these add up to 100%. Like if we were to add all of these together, it would add up to 100%. So a sales representative has to fall somewhere. She has to close 0, 1, 2, 3, all the way up to 20. One of those must be the answer. So if we look at any range, we can add them together. Alright, so the probability of closing 15 or more. How much did you say? What's the percentage of that?
Well, because I have to add them now, right?
Yep, so you have to add them, but you're going to get about the same thing. That's the reason why I said it sounded right to me.
Oh, yeah, because 16 and 17 are really tiny. So
yeah,
about 16.
16, maybe it's going to add up to 2. You're going to put this together, and it's going to get close to 2. It's going to get closer to 2, and these are going to get basically nothing. But these are possibilities, except you just can't see them on the graph because they're so small. Okay, so if you closed 15 out of 20 deals, and you go back to all your friends in the sales room, what do you say about how much better you were than everyone else? Can you quantify exactly how much better you were? Yes?
Would we say it was like 2%? About 98% better?
Yeah, you're better than 98% of the people. You could also say you're in the top 2%.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you could say that. All right, either of those statements would be accurate. All right, so now this frequency distribution, it looks a little bit more like our classic bell curve, right? Now, we don't know why that is. It could be because there's larger numbers, right? Because we have a lot of sales representatives, and you know, we have an average number of sales closes, and the probability being a little bit higher, a little bit lower, it all evens out. The other reason why it potentially could be our classic bell curve is because there's nothing weird going on in the upper or lower part. There's no reason why if someone is a little bit better, they would be a lot better. And we'll talk about what some of those weird reasons might be. I just want to whet your appetite to that now. Okay, so these first two distributions were discrete frequency distributions, where the outcome was discrete, meaning we have a finite number of possibilities. In this example, we have 20 different possibilities. In the previous example, we had 5 different possibilities. So this is a discrete outcome, all right, a specific outcome. Now, we are going to move on to a continuous frequency distribution, which means we have more than 20, we have infinitely many outcomes because we fill in all the possibilities in between each of these numbers. So let's look at this continuous probability distribution, height of trees in Canada. All right, so a lot of trees in Canada, right? A lot of trees, snow, whatever, all right. So we have height on the horizontal axis. 100 inches looks like the middle average height. We start at 0, we go all the way up to 200. We may even go past 200. In fact, you know, in theory, this could go on forever. There'd be very, very low probability of any tree being way beyond that. And the frequency is percentage. I just didn't fill it in, but it's, you know, between 0 and 100%. 100% is probably up here. Okay. So this is a continuous frequency distribution, meaning that there are infinite possibilities between 100 and 80, are between 100 and 99. Of these millions of trees we might have in Canada, they could each be a tiny, tiny difference in height. So we don't put all of those, we just assume that every possible number is represented and there is every possible outcome in actual height. All right, so that's the first big step in this graph, is that this is a continuous frequency distribution. Now, we can still look at it the same way in terms of top 5%, bottom 5%, middle 50%. We could still draw those same conclusions. We could still say, all right, where's, you know, remember in this previous one with the Verizon, we said there's a 49% probability of being within here. All right, if we had these numbers, we could tell, we could say, here's 49% of the trees are within this amount. If a tree is this tall, that tree is in the top 2%. We could draw all of those same conclusions. The other thing I'll point out is that this is a normal distribution. This is the classic bell curve. A couple of reasons why it's a normal distribution. One, because we have an equal probability of being a little bit taller or a little bit shorter than the average. And we have equal probabilities as we go further and further from the average. And that's really just a fancy way of saying that this is symmetric on both sides. So let's think about that for a minute. The average height of a tree in Canada is how tall?
100 inches.
It is 100 inches. That is the middle number. All right, half the trees are higher, half the trees are shorter, and if we were to add up all the heights, add them all together, divide by the total number of trees in Canada, we would get 100, suppose. All right, so that is our average. We'll call that our mean for now. The probability of being a little bit taller is the same as the probability of being a little bit shorter. Now, why would that be? Okay, well, maybe it's just because there's a random chance of being a little bit taller, random chance of being a little bit shorter. All right, to be a slightly taller tree, maybe you need a little more sunlight, a little better genetics, a little more water, you need to be at the right place in the canyon, whatever. The probability then of being a little bit shorter could be based on all of those same things. Make sense? All right, and why this is normally distributed is because the chance of being a little bit taller is the same as the chance of being a little bit shorter. The chance of being much taller, same as the probability of being much shorter. And so on and so forth. The chance of being super tall is the same as the chance of being super short. So if all of that is true, then this is normally distributed data. Now there could be some reasons why it's not true, which we'll talk about later, but in this example it is. Right. So, let's talk now about central tendency. I warmed you up with the mean, the average. We're going to discuss two more terms, the medium and the mode. So let's think about these three things, be clear about what they are, and we'll look at some examples. Mean. I mentioned that is the average, like the average height of all those millions of trees in Canada. We add them all up, divide by the total number of trees, we get the mean. Medium. What is the medium?
The middle number, if you arrange the numbers in ascending order, you get the middle number.
Exactly. All right, we arrange all the numbers, pick the middle one or the middle two, and we get the median. Mode, what's the mode?
The number that appears the most.
Most common number, outstanding. All right, so let's go through each of these. We'll spend a little bit of time on the math for the mean, because this will be important for our statistical knowledge going forward. All right, so the mean Instead, is the average of all the data of the values. If the data from a population, if the data are from a population,